Hello, Refuge Sunday School class. I hope that you and your families are doing well. I am so thankful that we are now able to worship together again on Sunday mornings. But we will plan to continue our class with pre-recorded lessons until we can restart our Sunday School hour. So for 5 weeks, we have been going through a series called Lives Lived for the Glory of God, Christian Missionaries Who Gave Their Lives for the Gospel. And we will continue using this book entitled From Jerusalem to Iron Gyra by Ruth Tucker. This is a great book for learning a biographical history of Christian missionaries. So far, we have covered Paul, Polycarp, William Carey, Adoniram Judson, John Williams, and John G. Patton. Today, let's turn our attention to John Coleridge Patteson. His life is really an example of Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, which reads, "Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary." I also think about Matthew chapter 19, verse 29, that reads, "And everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or children, or farms for my name's sake, will receive many times as much and will inherit eternal life." Over the past 2 weeks, we have been discussing missionary service in the South Pacific. We first talked about John Williams, and then last week we learned about the life and ministry of John G. Patton. Today, as we discuss the life and ministry of John Coleridge Patteson, he also had a passionate vision for the South Pacific. Patteson gave it all for missions. He forsook the joys of marriage and family. He also sacrificed his wealth for the passion of his heart, which was to see those who have never heard the name of Jesus come to salvation in faith. You see, Patteson is considered one of the most effective and renowned missionaries to the South Pacific. He was the first Anglican bishop of Melanesia, and a great nephew of the English poet Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Patteson was born in 1827 to a well-off English family. His father was well-respected as a judge, and he made sure that his son received the best education possible, first attending Etowah and then Oxford. It was at Oxford that a family friend named Bishop George Selwyn encouraged Patteson to consider ministry as a vocation. So after graduation, Patteson pursued ordination as an Anglican priest and then had the opportunity to serve in a local parish for 1 year before deciding to set sail to the South Seas in 1855, again through the encouragement and influence of Bishop Selwyn. So Bishop George Selwyn, who was the first Anglican bishop to New Zealand, shared similarities with Patteson. They both were affluent and well-educated. You know, as a side note, this is the first missionary that we have covered in this series who did not come out of poverty. But Bishop Selwyn had served in the South Pacific for more than a decade and was in great need of someone like Patteson to help oversee an enormous diocese that he was responsible for, which covered a large area of the Pacific Islands, including Melanesia. Bishop Selwyn guarded this region really as if it was like his personal domain. As Patteson began ministering in the South Seas, he enjoyed working as a team with Bishop Selwyn. Patteson found a thriving mission enterprise with 22 mission stations and around 50,000 people who participated in the mission. This work had begun in 1814 with the arrival of Samuel Marsden, who was an Anglican chaplain from Australia. Much of the church's growth had come since 1830, when more than 30,000 people had come into the church for instruction. This was largely due to the completion of the New Testament into the native language. The Anglicans joined with the Methodists in training new believers and also in church planting. By the Lord's great faithfulness and through the work of the Holy Spirit, it was reported in 1851 by the General Secretary of the Methodist Mission, scriptural Christianity has taken deep root in the native mind and is generally received throughout the length and breadth of the land. Very few remain in heathenism. Almost all the Aboriginal families throughout New Zealand read the scriptures and pray together both morning and evening. This was truly a great report showing the work of God. As you remember, just 2 weeks ago, we discussed the ministry of John Williams, who had a passion for reaching these people in the South Pacific, but he was eaten by cannibals. He sacrificed himself for the cause of the gospel. But the Lord has now brought salvation to this land. Praise be to God. As in missionary work, trouble is not far down the road. Patteson's model for church growth would have to change. The mission work in New Zealand was closely tied to colonization, which was becoming a significant issue with the natives, who deeply resented the European colonists who were taking more and more land for themselves. As early as 1839, one missionary sent a serious warning about the danger of colonization. He wrote, "An increase of settlers must affect the Aborigines, and if colonization is carried forward in its various ramifications, we fear that the people will soon be swept away." As missionaries wrestled with this issue, Patteson went with Bishop Selwyn in 1856 for a tour of Melanesia. As the team sailed from island to island on their mission ship named the Southern Cross, they began to recruit native boys to join them on the ship, and they would return with the missionary team to New Zealand to be trained in a mission school. If you remember last week, John G. Patton raised up native teachers who accompanied him in his work, but Patteson decided to take this a step even further. He wanted to gather up the natives and give them an education so that he could send them back to their homes. He was convinced that this would be the best method for training natives in proper evangelism, theology, and healthy church growth strategies. And this would allow for natives to lead their own churches one day and ministries without dependence on European missionaries. So in New Zealand, Patteson had the great and overwhelming task of directing and leading the training school that consisted of students with different languages and social customs. But our Lord had called Patteson for this enormous task. You see, Patteson had a brilliant mind for linguistics and became fluent in 20 different Malaysian languages and dialects. Patteson was unique in that he had no desire to civilize the natives and always embraced his students' different cultures and social structures. As a boy's education was complete, Patteson would then accompany the boys back to their homes and help them establish ministry, and would then recruit more to return with him for the school. The Lord's work had certainly seemed to bless the mission strategy. For a time, Patteson had an enrollment of over 50 natives from 24 different islands. Ministry really seemed to be going well, but significant challenges would soon face the missionary work. You see, Patteson began to notice a change of attitudes from the people in the islands. Natives, for some reason, did not seem to trust Patteson as he had enjoyed for some time. Attitudes and mindsets were changing because of outside influences. Very quickly, outside commercial interests in the islands were growing as sugar and cotton plantations were emerging as highly profitable ventures. So this new found business would require an enormous labor force, and this led, unfortunately, to a big problem for Patteson. He struggled with not being associated with the new practice of blackbirding, which began to ravish the islands. According to one historian, the scum of the earth came to the Pacific in search of easy money in the blackbirding trade. Sometimes young men and boys were bribed or tricked into coming along willingly, but more often they were kidnapped. gangs of white seamen would go ashore and carry off men and youth at gunpoint. It is estimated that at some 70,000 young men were thus captured into slavery, rarely having the opportunity of returning home again. And as you might imagine, this terrible practice on the South Seas significantly hurt Patteson's ability to recruit young Native boys to the mission school. Even through issues of mistrust and difficulty, Patteson refused to give up. He kept trying. He continued working and trusting God. And in April of 1871, Patteson decided to set out on another tour of Melanesia in his mission ship, the Southern Cross. This journey was really met with great disappointment and frustration. Patteson just could not shake off the influence of the Blackfeathers. Natives were much more hesitant to send their boys off to the mission school. But Patteson did continue to see the work of God. He did get the joy of hosting a large service on the island of Mato, where more than 200 people were baptized. Can you imagine that? 200 people. But in general, the native people lived in terror, no longer seeking him out with the warm welcome that he had grown accustomed to. While on this tour, on September the 21st of 1871, the brilliant young Anglican bishop made his final stop on the Southern Cross. He had on board the crew, another missionary, and several young Melanesians who were on their way to Norfolk Island for training. But on this day, Patteson unfortunately met his death. He had just completed a morning Bible study and a lesson on the martyrdom of Stephen. He went ashore for what was supposed to be a routine stop, but Patteson sensed trouble almost as soon as he reached shore. Others who accompanied him ran back to the ship in the middle of a barrage of arrows. And back on the ship, everyone waited anxiously for some sign of their missionary leader, but there was no return. So after a while, some of the native boys decided to go back on the land to search for Patteson. As they approached the shore, they saw natives pushing what appeared to be an unmanned canoe onto the water towards them. And when they reached the canoe, they found Patteson's body. It was marked by 5 separate wounds, signifying that Patteson's life had been taken in revenge for 5 of their own men who had been seized by Blackfeathers. Many of the islanders were appalled by the murder, and for that reason his body had been washed and returned to the mission ship. Patteson's body was buried at sea, along with 2 other native Christians who died of the wounds they had sustained. Patterson's death drew world attention to the despicable business of blackbirding and helped eventually to bring about its demise. It also inspired many to dedicate their lives to the South Seas missionary work. Just as John Williams lost his life while visiting an island, so did Patteson. And both of their deaths inspired many others to dedicate their lives to South Sea missionary work. Thanks be to God that today they are rejoicing in heaven with many converts from these same islands who have eternal life in heaven because of their sacrifices and heart for the Great Commission. My great hope is that you will be inspired, that you will find the courage to truly impact people, that those around you, you would have a heart for the lost. You would have a heart for those who do not yet know the name of Jesus, and that you would share, and that you would be bold, that you would be a bold witness for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Many have died before us with that right to proclaim Christ. Might we lay down our lives as well to proclaim our Savior. Let's pray together for just a moment. Lord Jesus, we look at all these men and women over these past 6 weeks, and we are so thankful for their courage, for their boldness, for their ability to lay everything aside, all the comforts of this world, Lord, for your gospel. and for those who have never heard the name of Jesus. Would you, Lord, give us courage? Would you give us boldness? Would we speak of your name? And Lord, would we see people around us come to know Christ in salvation? And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thank you so much for watching this video, and I hope to see you all soon. Bye.